Penguin Random House Audio presents It's Up to You, The Practice of Self-Reflection on the Buddhist Path by Dzigar Kongtrul, read by Pema Chödrön.
Supplication to the Longchen Nigtig Lineage, Samantabhadra, Vajrasattva, and Vajradharma, teachers of the mind lineage, make everything auspicious. Garab Dorje, Manjushri Mitra, Sri Singha, Janana Sutra, Vimala Mitra, Padmasambhava, hosts of teachers of the symbol lineage, protect me with your blessings, your compassion, and your wisdom. Dharma King Trisan Detson and your sons, Great Translator Lord Vairochana, Chief of Dakinis, Queen of Great Bliss, teachers of the hearing lineage, pearls and a rosary garland, pour forth the blessings of your wisdom mind. Second Buddha of this age of dregs, Longchenpa, Jigme Lingpa, Kenze Wangpo, Dharma Lord Jamgun Kuntral, Renunciate Patral, Great Treasure Discoverer Chogyur Lingpa, and the rest, root and lineage teachers, bestow your blessings in the center of my heart. Lord Emanation of Kenze, Soul Eye of the World, Mighty Sovereign Tenzin Gyatso, Unique Protector of the World, Jamyong Dorje, Dharma Master of the World, and all my teachers free from the flaws of the world. With the compassionate embrace of your wisdom, look upon me and think of me with kindness. How could someone dull and confused like me, a bum who just eats, sleeps, and shits, introduce anyone to the sacred Dharma? It must be that the merit I have gathered in past lives was not that small. Since I have met in person all you Buddhas with your eyes of wisdom, and had the fortune to study the meaning of what you taught. Thus, with purest intention and in accordance with my teacher's command, whatever I have tried to say to help my mother sentient beings, I have made a semblance of compiling in this small volume. May all who as much as see, hear, or think of it gradually become disciples of all you Buddhas, and spontaneously accomplishing the twofold goal, attain perfect enlightenment. Written by Dzigar Kongtrul Jigme Namgyel, Mangalam. Introduction. The desire for happiness is universal, and beyond finding happiness and meaning in our lives, most of us want to be good, decent human beings. Wanting to be good, happy, and decent is not only a reasonable desire, but also a noble one. Ironically, much of the time we struggle with how to go about accomplishing this. We have an idea of how we want to be, but we always find ourselves running up against our doubts, fears, and insecurities. On the spiritual path, we speak of enlightenment. But how do we reconcile enlightenment with what we see when we look in the mirror? If we strive for enlightenment by trying to bypass our confusion, our practice will remain divorced from our immediate experience. Yet, when we focus only on our habitual tendencies, we get bogged down in our own self-absorption and pain. This struggle to reconcile the notion we have of enlightenment with our own confusion is the very starting point of the path. It is an expression of our deep yearning for freedom and happiness, which is itself an indication of the great potential of mind we all possess. At the same time, the fact that we have this greater potential does not mean that we are completely noble or enlightened from the start. We may have confusion, but instead of trying to either sidestep or fight against our confusion, we can make good use of it. It takes some maturity to learn to accommodate both our greater potential and our neuroses. We can develop this maturity through the practice of self-reflection. Self-reflection is the spirit and practice of honestly looking at whatever arises in our experience without judgment. Habitually, this is difficult for us to do. Our tendency is to try to rid ourselves of unpleasant experiences and to chase after pleasant ones. The unique beauty and kindness of the practice of self-reflection is that it does not demand that we experience anything other than what we experience. Looking without bias brings both the great potential of mind and our confusion into the light of our innate intelligence. Doing so alters the historical struggle we have with our mind, transforming it into the very basis of the path of enlightenment. Self-reflection is the common thread that runs through all traditions and lineages of Buddhist practice. It protects our practice from becoming just another enterprise by breathing life into the teachings and making them a living experience. Part 1, The Practice of Self-Reflection. Chapter 1, Looking in the Mirror. When we look in the mirror, the one thing we don't want to see is an ordinary human being. We would like to see someone special. Whether we are conscious of this or not, we are simply not content to see an ordinary human being with neuroses, obstacles, and problems. We want to see a happy person, but instead, we see someone who is struggling. We want to think of ourselves as compassionate, but instead we see someone who is selfish. We long to be elegant, but our arrogance makes us crass. And instead of a strong or immortal person, we see someone who is vulnerable to the four streams of birth, old age, sickness, and death. The conflict between what we see and what we want to see causes tremendous pain. The pain of self-importance. We are imprisoned in this pain by a sense of specialness or self-importance. Self-importance is the underlying clinging we have to I, me, 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 mine, 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 which colors all of our experience. If we look closely, we find a strong element of self-importance in everything we think, say, and do. How can I feel good? What will others think? What will I gain? What will I lose? These questions are all rooted in our self-importance. Even our feeling of not measuring up to who we think we should be is a form of self-importance. We like to see ourselves as strong and in control, but we are more like a fragile eggshell that is easily broken. This makes us feel deeply vulnerable and not in a good way. This vulnerable self requires protection, armoring, the gathering of forces and the construction of walls. As a result, we become painfully trapped. We are increasingly fearful of relaxing with things as they are and increasingly uncertain that anything will work out the way we would like. It takes courage to go beyond self-importance to see who we really are, but this is our path. The point of all Buddhist teachings, formal or informal, is to reduce self-importance and make room for the truth. This process begins with self-reflection. A questioning spirit. The great Indian Pandita Ayadeva, the principal disciple of Nagarjuna, who was known for compiling and expounding the teachings on the emptiness view, once said that to merely question that things might not be as they seem could shake the very foundation of habitual clinging. This questioning spirit is the starting point for self-reflection. Could it be that this tightly knit sense of self is not what it seems? Do we really need to hold everything together, and can we? Is there life beyond self-importance? These kinds of questions open the door to investigating the cause of our pain. The actual practice of self-reflection requires us to step back, examine our experience, and not succumb to the momentum of habitual mind. This allows us to look without judgment at whatever arises, and this goes directly against the grain of our self-importance. Self-reflection is the common thread that runs through all traditions and lineages of Buddhist practice. It also takes us beyond the boundaries of formal practice. We can bring the questioning spirit of self-reflection to any situation at any time. Self-reflection is an attitude, an approach, and a practice. In a nutshell, it is a way to make practice come alive for us personally. Our true face. If we look at our habitual mind without deception or judgment, we will see beyond it to who we truly are, beyond the self and what it does or doesn't want, beyond the self that is constantly fighting or tugging at the world, lies our true nature and true face. This is a face of our natural state, free from the struggle to become what we are not. It's the face of a potentially realized being whose wisdom, qualities, and courage are beyond measure. Seeing both our deeper potential and our hindrances, we begin to understand the cause of our suffering, and we can begin to do something about it. When we practice self-reflection, we take liberation into our own hands. This uncompromising path demands true courage and fearlessness. Going beyond the ordinary notion of self leads directly to the truth of our Buddha essence, our true face, and to freedom from suffering. The spookiness of ego mind. Holding to an ordinary notion of self or ego is the source of all our pain and confusion. The irony is that when we look for this self that we're cherishing and protecting, we can't even find it. The self is shifty and ungraspable. When we say, "I'm old," we're referring to our body as self. When we say, "my body," the self becomes the owner of the body. When we say, "I'm tired," the self is equated with physical or emotional feelings. The self is our perceptions when we say, "I see," and our thoughts when we say, "I think." When we can't find a self within or outside of these parts, we may then conclude that the self is that which is aware of all these things, the knower or mind. But when we look for the mind, we can't find any shape or color or form. This mind that we identify as the self, which we could call ego mind, controls everything we do. Yet it can't actually be found, which is somewhat spooky, as if a ghost were managing our home. The house seems to be empty, but all the housework has been done. The bed has been made, our shoes have been polished, the tea has been poured, and the breakfast has been cooked. The funny thing is that we never question this. We just assume that someone or something is there. But all this time, our life has been managed by a ghost, and it's time to put a stop to it. On one hand, ego mind has served us, but it hasn't served us well. It has lured us into the suffering of samsara.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.